Bienvenue, mon amis. Before we begin the next installment of C'est quoi, c'est bordel, we should share with you an epiphany I have about the previous film we saw last time, The Dead Matter. If one thinks about it, it is the story of this unlikable, extremely hubristic person trying to bring something back from the dead that should never have been brought back in the first place. And should have stayed dead and left behind. And then you realize that's exactly what the person was doing by making the movie in the first place. It's a Metamobius strip where the director somehow imprint himself into the movie, doing exactly what he should not be doing by making the movie. Freudian slip, I wonder. I mention this because in the next project we view today, we're going to see the same thing happen. We're going to see a man bring something back from the dead that he should have left behind. We're also going to see the same man imprint everything he does wrong in his own film. Absolutely amazing. The Metamobius strip continue. And with that, I bring you the case of Mark Borchardt. I said before last episode, Jacques know better than to try to do something that someone else do. I'm not gonna try playing professional sports. I'm not gonna try becoming some great musician. I make movies and that's what I do. But for some reason, I see this happen a lot. You get people who find these crossroads, rock bottoms of life, don't know what to do with themselves, and suddenly decide they want to make a movie. And we're going to see that very thing happen today. I give you the movie of the making of the movie that was brought back from the dead after the movie that the movie was following being made died. Just try to follow that.
I was a failure. I was a failure and I get very sad and depressed about it.
And that's the very beginning. Not a good start. We're supposed to like this guy, aren't we?
And I can't be that no more. I really feel like I've betrayed myself big time. Because I think when I was growing up, I had all the potential in the world. Now I'm back to being Mark, who has a beer in his hand and is thinking about the great American script and the great American movie.
There are many ways to make a film. It's a very subjective endeavor. So I would never say that there is a must-do list that one has to do to make a good movie. But I would say there is a must-not-do list. And they're already starting right off on it.
And this time I cannot fail. I won't fail. It's not in me. You don't get second chances and mess them up. You'd be a fool to. Not just finishing films or in the long run getting some money, but it's right now. I feel like it's, like I said, 5, 10, 15 years ago. Now I've got the same options again, and this time I'm not going to fail. This time it's most important not to fail, just to drink and dream, but rather to create and complete.
Do remember that he said that.
I don't believe it, man. Life is kind of cool sometimes.
Remember that title as well. Watch how it begins to make the Northwestern movie, and watch how the people dwindle more and more and more. Till he finally just pulls a plug. We're about a quarter of the way into the film, and he already gave up on making the movie this movie was in the making of. That's not good.
The realization seriously hit me. No way. I have absolutely no fucking money. I have no hope of getting any money until Colvin is finished.
You notice the film was called The Making of Northwestern. Northwestern never got made. It never even began. And suddenly he decided to dump the project and go back to a project he already started and abandoned that as well. So the film just lied to us.
This is ridiculous. We started May 94, man. We've got every f-stop known to man in the film.
In Taoist philosophy over in the East, they have these ideas of misguided thoughts being known as diseases. And one of them is a disease of wishing to demonstrate all your knowledge. The only reason to ever put every f-stop known to man in a film is just to put every f-stop known to man in a film. Which is nothing more than, once again, cinematic masturbation.
Colvin, man, we gotta get this sucker done, though. Seriously.
Remember what he said at the very beginning of the film? Eh? Repeating himself already. But, believe it or not, he does actually manage to film this one. But that right there pretty much sums up the process.
At least me anyway, just feel kind of sorry for him, pity him, that he felt that way. Honestly, I thought that he was going to grow up to be like a stalker, a serial killer.
Remember that, because we're going to address that in part two.
I don't want to end up being nothing.
We'll get back to that as well. Amazingly, he does manage to get all the way to post-production this time. And with that, the actors go utterly insane as they realize what they are participating in, as evidenced here. To further make him on point, I direct you to this ADR session.
It's the first line of the film, man. It's gotta be on the money here.
It's alright,
Okay, cut. Alright, man.
It's alright. There's something to live for.
And take 10.
It's alright. It's okay. It's something to live for. Jesus told me so.
Bill, you couldn't ask for anything better. I think it was recorded too high. Give it all you got. What take is this?
16.
This is take 16. Let's go. Take 30.
It's all right.
Hold up. Take 30.
It's all right. It's okay. This Jesus told me so. There's something to live for.
Okay. Cut. Take 31.
First of all, just write the damn line down so he can simply read it off a sheet of paper if he can't remember it. Secondly, the entire point of ADR is to sync the dialogue with an actual image. You have no image to sync it to. You have no idea if you got one right or not.
That there was something that seemed to go wrong or did not go as planned. And he always seemed to forge ahead and go through with the project.
That statement right there sums up the entire film. I would give him a grudging respect for determination alone. But just wait. The film is completed and they have a theatrical premiere! Congratulations! The movie on the making of the movies that never got made is now completed! The irony of that actually physically hurts me. So now the projector rolls and they present Corvin. Backwards, apparently. Oh no.
It's alright, it's okay. There's something to live for. Jesus told me so.
Dirty takes of ADR, and that's what they ended up with. I see the film rebelled and killed him. No jury would ever convict it. Oh no, not again. Nothing good has ever come from our hero suddenly waking up.
You'll have your goddamn article, alright?
And the Metamobius strip returns. Mark Borchardt is playing a man who can't finish anything. Does every horrible filmmaker feel the need to put everything wrong with themselves on the screen?
And, 1, 2, 3. Three of you, allegedly assumed to get me out of this fucking tragedy.
Oh. First the film tries to kill him, now he's trying to get out of it himself. Everyone why should be fleeing the cinema right now.
I'll get it done. Because I've got to get it done.
Gee, haven't we heard that at least twice before?
Shit.
Now I'm surely convinced that the film is indeed self-aware.
And don't make me regret this, man.
Too late, we already do. And another very brief shot of puking in the toilet. I'm wondering now if the dead matter was a deliberate homage to Corvin.
You can't keep living like you do without consequences. Events like this can have long-term effects that might not be immediately apparent.
You mean, like, really bad acting?
Well, I hope we won't be seeing you again, if you know what I mean.
The film already tried to kill him once, and he survived. We're going to be seeing a lot more of him. That is indeed the proper response of anyone who realizes it's in this piece of shit film.
Simplistic, spiritual quest for a better life. We, as all others in this world, have suffered through pain in our lives.
We shot that unsavory. I can't even ask if the cameraman attended film school. I'll have to ask if he attended film kindergarten. Are they holding that meeting inside a janitor's closet? Nobody fought.
It's my husband's the one who's really got the problem. I'm just the one who has to live with it. He's got this stressful job. He only works 30 hours a week. Doesn't get any benefits from his job. But he's sitting at this job, waiting to get in full time, which I don't think is ever going to happen.
Know what else is never going to happen? She's never going to tell her what this horrible job actually is.
And you get into like a comfort zone of where this is all going to be.
This film knows nothing of what the comfort zone is.
Bless you all. Thank God for this group.
And here is the director in the bathroom at the premiere of the film, realizing what a horrible mistake he has made. By the by, it cuts on the shots of the group to him inside the bathroom, right back to him as a group. Well done.
I really don't know what to say.
An apology comes to mind.
I guess it keeps my head above the water, and ultimately that's what counts.
And then it cuts to him just leaving. That last shot contributed nothing, and it just stopped.
Are we going to be seeing you again?
Notice how no one in the film can say that convincingly? No one wants to see him again.
Oh, come on. Give me a break.
Looks like he just did. That scene lasted all of 10 seconds. Next, he drives out into the wilderness and just starts walking around all by himself. Why is he doing this? Oh, so a bunch of robed people can descend upon him, despite no one knowing he was going out there. If you were attempting to create traumatic tension, making honking goose noises has the opposite effect. Oh no! This horrible cult has forced him to have to wash his clothes! Really? That's all they're going to do? You know what? If an evil, clothes dirtying cult was chasing me through the woods, the absolute last thing I would do would be stop running.
This isn't poison, you know what, is it?
Looks more like it was filled with nitrous oxide. No one should laugh that hard at something that wasn't even funny. What happened to Mike Shanks there? Did he get stung in the face by about 10,000 honeybees?
I used to get busted a lot for going into my day program drunk, so I went in there on 3 hits of acid just to prove him wrong.
That would be proving them right.
I don't need your worthless meanings. I can do whatever I want.
Then why are you here?
I've tried to kill myself twice.
Further proof that no one can escape this film.
I hate myself for it.
Do I feel any remorse? Absolutely.
This film is so transparent. Everyone's making their regrets about being in it known. See? The guilt of being in the film just shattered his mind. Why is there a random priest in the bathroom? I've heard of shitty sermons before, but this...
Ah, top of the evening, Mikey. Cut out a tad early on us, did you? And without a hint of due explanation.
I don't believe you heard the full gist of my story.
I can't even comment on this. I really have no idea what's happening.
Mike, where the hell did you go?
He tried to freeze the movie again? I don't blame him.
Let us help you.
I imagine Mark heard that a lot after this film premiered.
Why not?
It's not.
Why the fuck not?
It's a club, man.
Why the fuck not?
A club, man. It's a human club.
What club? Are they paying you for it?
It's a club, Jack.
Are they paying you for it?
Nope.
Why ain't they paying you for it?
I don't know who they are. I don't know what they're talking about. And that scene had no point.
What am I talking about? They put some shit in my drink.
It would be only fair. You put some shit on the screen.
Nobody's after you.
Well, except was a lynch mob at the premiere demanding some money back.
What do you got, a problem with vampires around here or something?
After the dead matter, everyone has a problem with vampires.
Oh, do any problems ever get solved in this organization, or what?
Wow. That's actually the first intelligent line in the entire film.
We have proven capabilities.
Yes, which include getting people's clothes dirty and then not chasing them. You must all know by now that they were the people in the ropes by now.
That dark, destructive excrement which you call life.
No, that would be called coven. And then they all go cuckoo. I don't know. And once again he goes off by himself for no reason at all, telling no one where he was going, and there they are again! I know better than Zacchaeus this time. He could drive off at any time, and he does not. All he has to do is hit the gas. Is it a coven doing all the hitting? I suspect this was not part of the movie, this was actually a mutiny on set by the crew. And then they just leave. Why did that happen?
Well, well, look who's here!
If this coven really wanted to keep coming back, shouldn't their strategy be not terrorizing him? Ah, I see they're going to stick with their tried and true ways. And then they cut to random exterior shot. Why is this happening? What's the point of this?
You should have at least given us a call.
They pulled a gun on him. Why is he even in the same room with them?
And what's the matter with you, man?
You made the film, ask yourselves that. And now random violence yet again. Fuck it. So he beats them both up and doesn't run away. Again. You do realize they're still alive, right? And with that, it's over. I would give you a summation of my thoughts on the film, but I think Mike Shank can do it better than I can. My sentiments exactly. And if you really want some horror, I must warn you, we're not done yet. There's more to come in part 2. See you all then.